welcome everybody. Welcome to the kickoff of the first principle series by Oracle, where we talk about Oracle Cloud Infrastructure and talk about the engineering efforts and design choices behind the next generation cloud platform. So customers routinely ask me how we can achieve scale, economics, and network performance that we do for a wide range of workloads when they try OCI. And we thought it'd be fun to talk about these things from an engineering lens. I'm excited to be here and kick this off with Pradeep Vincent, and where you get to learn about our design choices. This video is about our recent announcement, Dedicated Region Cloud at Customer, which brings the exact same economics, the exact same services, and exact same operation capabilities to customers on-premises. So what we offer in our public cloud, we can offer to customers on-premises now. So first, quick intros. Pradeep, why don't you tell the audience, what do you do here at Oracle?
Absolutely. Thanks, Salman. My name is Pradeep Vincent. I'm one of the lead architects with OCI, Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. I've been with the Oracle more than 6 years now. Before that, I was at AWS working on various core services in core engineering for about 7-8 years before that. In OCI, I've been involved in, you know, from the ground up architecture for Gen 2 infrastructure, which we now call as OCI. I was involved in bare metal architecture, particularly with focus on security, our network architecture and database services, some of our security products. And the last couple of years, I've been primarily focused on cross OCI architecture, you know, including dedicated region a cloud customer. How about you, Salman?
So I lead cloud engineering and product management for cloud, dedicated region cloud customer. You've been here much longer than I have. I've been here 9 months or 10 months roughly now at Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. Super excited to be here. And, you know, and as I learn about Oracle's design choices, about its engineering efforts, and how we can provide customers superior network performance, superior economics, and superior security of their for cloud infrastructure designed for enterprise workloads, I'm super excited about the journey and the customer interactions I'm having so far. So with that, let's get to it, Pradeep. Let's talk about dedicated region, cloud customer, the thing that we announced back in July, or there we did, on Oracle Live. And, you know, when I talk to customers about dedicated regions, there's a general reaction of disbelief. When I say, hey, it's the exact same public cloud services, exact same operations, exact same economics, there's this general reaction of disbelief. They don't think what they're getting is a real cloud region. So let's start talking about first principles of region design and how our public and regions and dedicated regions are related and different.
Yeah, it is a very legitimate question, isn't it? It's a question I've heard multiple times as well. I think to really understand why OCI architecture is, you know, amenable and suitable for dedicated region, I think we kind of need to go back in time and look at, you know, how we architected OCI from the ground up, right? We started the architecture 6 years back. Mm-hmm. You know, back in the day when we took a step back and looked at our customer base, our target customer base, and asked ourselves, what is it that they're missing that the other cloud providers are not providing, right? Okay. One of the things, there are many things there, but one of the main things that we figured out very quickly was that our customers really wanted their regions to be close to their home. They wanted that to be in their country in most cases for a variety of reasons. For example, some of them have latency, bandwidth, connectivity to their on-prem environment concerns. Some of them have security and compliance as their motivation. Some people have data residency as the motivation. But for one reason or the other, many of our customers wanted regions closer to their country, right? So for that reason, one of our fundamental goals was to essentially launch as many regions as possible in as many countries as possible with incredible speed, speed being the operative word, right? So we kind of essentially took that architectural approach wherein we can build many, perhaps even smaller regions, and scale them up as we, you know, as they organically grow, but, you know, launch as many regions as possible. And we, you know, with dedicated regions, all we are doing is essentially taking the same architectural principles and extending that to dedicated region.
Got it. So I think this is key, right? A lot of people think that when they talk about cloud regions or they think about cloud regions, they all have to be mega scale to begin with. But I think what you're describing is that I think an OCI has mega scale regions across the globe, but we don't necessarily have to start that way. And the ability to serve customers, because Oracle has tens of thousands of enterprise customers served today, you guys had to get there really quickly. So quite frankly, I guess your customers led you to a design model where you could start small and then scale incrementally quickly. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, at the end of the day, we absolutely have large regions. And we also, you know, have small regions. So our architectural approach is essentially to be suitable for both the scenarios. That's the key, right? So that way we can support the, you know, we can do a great job with the mega regions, but also when we, you know, we can also launch smaller regions, including dedicated regions, and grow them as we come along. I think one of the keys there is essentially the way we automate region build, right? Like we automated that to the nth degree, more than, you know, any other cloud provider that I know of. And that really allows us to launch regions much faster, right? And, you know, if you can see, like we launched, what, 25 regions already in the last 4 years, you know, compared to any of the public cloud. So you can see the contrast there.
I hope our operations SDEs are, you know, have all the tools to manage and operate those regions, the fact that we're launching them quickly. So I wouldn't want to be in their shoes, but I know our customers are really enjoying this type of experience we can deliver for them. So let's break this down further. Let's talk about three major things, such as which I think customers ask for us. How do they achieve high availability? How do they achieve fault isolation and elasticity? So let's start with talking about high availability, because that's a core tenet of any cloud provider. So how should customers think about high availability in dedicated region?
Well, from a customer standpoint, I think they should think about the same thing, same way as they do with any other public region. But, you know, the trick here is to look at it closely enough where there are fundamental differences there that actually matter. As an example, if you look at closely our data center power redundancy model, right, there are fundamental differences that essentially allows us to be much more amenable to a dedicated region while also preserving the redundancy and fault tolerance that public cloud offers.
So you're saying that even our public cloud region design has different tendency, which sort of flow down to dedicated region relative to how other cloud vendors have gone about it?
Yeah, exactly. So for example, with, you know, the power redundancy model that we have. So if you look at, you know, the data center power components, there's, you know, what I call as upstream components, which are essentially, you know, your power, substation, your transformers, your generators, UPS, you know, so on and so forth. And generally, you know, those upstream components have redundancy built into them in some fashion, generators, redundant cooling system, so on and so forth. And most cloud providers have that, and OCI, we have that as well. It's no different than that, right?
Got it.
But if you look at the downstream components, your rack PDUs, RPDUs, or the, you know, the power supply line going to each individual server, there, if you look at it, many cloud providers essentially have a single power line going to the server. We, on the other hand, we have redundancy for the power supply going all the way to the server. And that makes a big difference.
For each server, we're doing redundancy?
Pretty much every server, right? And the reason for that is, if you step back and think about it, I think the real question is, why is it the other cloud providers haven't done that? If you think about it, if you have a really big region, their argument really is, you know, at any given time, thanks to the redundancy in the upstream components, it's okay if a small part of the region actually fails. That's okay because the other parts of the region are going to be up. And as long as you have, you know, fault tolerance across them, you're going to be okay.
Okay.
The challenge here is twofold. One, as you, when you have smaller regions, such as dedicated region, that doesn't quite hold up. So that's one. And two, some of the enterprise customers are, you know, actually need or want a desire to have redundancy of power all the way to the server. So for that reason, we fundamentally architected our cloud so that we have redundant power all the way to the server, independent of, you know, whether it's a large region, a small region, or a dedicated region. Yeah. It's the same architecture.
Yeah, that may be a cost to Oracle, but I think what you're describing to me, customers tell me at least when I chat with them that, hey, our bare metal capabilities, like having a single server, having that additional redundancy means higher uptime for that scenarios. And I think customers appreciate that. So I think that's super helpful. And for the audience, I think that will be helpful to see the differences in terms of how we think about downstream and upstream components. So that's high. That's achieving potentially a portion of high availability to that. But let's talk about fault isolation. Is multi-AZ the only deployment option for customers to achieve high availability and fault isolation? What are their options?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So if you think about dedicated region, right, and many customers want to start with a smaller footprint, and in many cases, a single data center. What we have fundamentally is, you know, we have a construct called fault domain. And what that is it's a fine-grained fault isolation construct that works even within a particular data center. So if you think about two VMs in two different fault domains, they are guaranteed not to be on the same server, and not to be on the same, not to share the same top of rack switch, you know, they don't share rack VDUs and things like that, right?
I see.
In addition to that, you know, one of the things that experience has taught us, both in OCI as well as in other cloud providers, is that the changes is actually one of the biggest sources of failures, right? What I mean by is that change of any form, software changes as well as physical operations, fundamentally is a source of failures, right? But clearly that's inevitable. Change, the only constant in life is, of course, change, right? So we have to constantly change things, but that is also a source of failure. So one of the things we did is that we have a change management policy in place, our mechanisms and tools and services that essentially enforce a tight alignment between our change management cadence with not just availability domains, but also our fault domains. So what that boils down to is that the chances of probability of a correlated failure across fault domain is substantially lower as a result.
So even our services are aware of the fault domain construct and use that to provide a high availability experience to customers. And to, if I heard this correctly, and I want to replay this back to you, this fault domain construct is that physical and logical separation of resources within that single data center, achieving higher availability, even a single data center deployment. And I've heard from customers, and I want you to tell me this is true also, which is the fact that they can deploy in a single availability domain or a single data center, but have fault domain isolation for high availability, they can achieve better latency characteristics because all their workloads are sort of really nicely put together that way.
Yeah. In enterprise world, as we talk to customers, we find a variety of workloads, right? And some of them want to have, you know, different data centers and essentially have replication across them. And we have those as well. We have regions that, many regions that have multiple data centers or availability domains. In some cases, you know, applications are essentially, what they want to do is essentially have clustered replication, if you will, that have very tight latency requirement, and then have a DR mechanism on top of it. There, you know, what they typically end up doing is they replicate across fault domains and then have a DR mechanism from one data center.
One data center to the other data center. I think that's super helpful. So I think if I were to recap, we've talked about high availability fault isolation, which is core to any cloud infrastructure that anyone uses. The last question that I get from customers is, hey, is dedicated region offer the same elasticity? How do customers can get elasticity with smaller regions? What are their options there?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I mean, at the end of the day, if you think about elasticity, what is it? Elasticity is, at the end of the day, is kind of an illusion, right? The illusion that public cloud providers, how they achieve it is essentially they multiplex a lot of different workloads on a common fungible set of, you know, server hardware. Right. And that essentially allows them to provide a pay-per-use pricing model, mm-hmm. and also have a capacity management story where, you know, the peaks and troughs of, you know, capacity requirements don't have to be planned for ahead of time. So that's okay. Essentially what customers perceive as elasticity, right? In order to do that, you kind of need a reasonable scale of fungible server pool. And with, you know, particularly with dedicated region, that becomes a big challenge. So we did a couple of big architectural things to help elasticity, even for dedicated regions. One of them is that we have, particularly when we launch a region at the initial stages, when the, you know, the scale is somewhat small, we have a more fungible server type pool for internal use cases. What that allows us to do is essentially have a more of a fungible server pool. So even for a given size, if you actually cut it up into different server types, then the pool of servers becomes even more smaller and very hard to achieve elasticity. So we kind of break that up and essentially have a common, you know, server type Now, as we scale the region, that's not necessarily the right solution because the cost of it is actually going to be high, and we don't want that. Mm-hmm. We want to limit the cost as well. So we essentially have a more fungible server pool that's, you know, where the server types are not that differentiated at the very early stages. And then as we scale it, we take a different strategy. And the multi-pronged strategy actually helps us bring elasticity even for, you know, small size dedicated region.
Yeah, I think for customers, when they think about this, and when I talk to them, I talk about their workloads. I talk about the elasticity that we need to provide for their workloads versus the elasticity of doing anything, right? Because it's all about that workload that they're trying to go solve for. And some workloads can easily go to the public cloud. And for those workloads that can't go to the public cloud quickly because they're bound by latency, data residency, regulation, the elasticity is, the function of elasticity is bound to that workload characteristic, which we can scale for because, as you said, we start with a common server type and then and incrementally add more capacity to that. Or give them a different server type as their workload needs change. So let's touch on this last piece, which you talked about, which is we have this, we can, you know, as this region scales up, we can add more capacity. Does that mean that even on supply chain, we do something different, where we can dynamically add capacity and remove capacity? What is that?
Absolutely. You know, if you think about it, like even with smaller regions where the scale of the region may be small, we actually have a giant scale advantage in terms of the number of regions. Right. So we take advantage of that. What we have is essentially a zonal buffer pool, if you will, for capacity management strategy, where we kind of keep the buffer capacity outside of the individual regions in a somewhat of a zonal fashion. And what that allows us to do is essentially buffer capacity fluctuations, the peaks and the troughs for individual data center or individual region rather, much better. And we, you know, essentially leverage the same thing for dedicated regions as well. And that helps, bring more elasticity even for dedicated regions.
All right, cool. I mean, those are the major questions I get from customers. And I think our customers would enjoy hearing from our architects, the people who are actually building and designing it, and how these things work. So we've covered availability, we've covered fault tolerance and resiliency, and we've covered elasticity and how dedicated region, the product that we recently launched, has the same characteristics as our public cloud regions because we took an approach 6 years ago to build them differently and operate them and scale them slightly differently versus the other cloud providers. So I hope everybody enjoyed this session. Pradeep, thanks for having me on this, you know, this kickoff series for first principles where we talk about engineering and design approaches to our Oracle Cloud infrastructure. And hope to be back next when we launch another product sometime later in the future.
Thank you, Salman.